Hello, my name is Peter van Eyck, and I am one of the world's most experienced independent cloud trainers. Let me talk to you about why cloud computing is the future of IT, and why it might well be the future of your job. IT has always been a pretty dynamic environment, but cloud computing may well be the biggest change the industry has faced so far.
So what do you think? Is cloud computing the next wave in information technology? Is it a load of marketing hype? Or is it a jump into the deep? I think there's truth in all of these. But personally, I think that cloud computing is primarily a state of mind, a way of thinking. So let's assume that you work with IT. You're an IT manager, a systems or a solutions architect, or any other IT role. Or you are involved in procuring IT, or as an auditor, or on the legal side of IT. I will give you a new perspective on how to organize IT. And that view will allow you to figure out which part of your job will disappear and which part of your job will grow. So cloud computing is a revolutionary change, or is it? Maybe cloud computing is following the same rules as other maturing industries. And to understand the future, we must first understand the past. The first commercial applications of IT were on the mainframe. You know, a big single computer filling a large room. There was one department running it, and it was serving an entire company. It had lots of people managing it. This is the kind of hardware that I wrote my first computer program on in 1973. Now we moved to client server in the 80s, where basically every department had a computer, and each computer had its own system manager. So ownership changed here, as well as the way in which decisions were made on computing. Then came the PC, and a little later, the internet. And one of the things that happened there was that companies no longer owned all the computers that users worked on. We moved stuff to customers that worked on their own computers. People at home owned them. Once again, a shift in the way ownership and responsibility for it was organized. Then we get the breakthrough of cloud computing, where companies no longer even own the servers that they work on. One way of looking at this whole shift is looking at who runs it, who pays the electricity bill. Is it the central department? Is it each business unit? Is it the user? Or is it totally outsourced to another company? In a few minutes, we will look at how the amount of people changes that we need to run one computer. Just remember that it took a whole team to manage a single mainframe computer. Now, each of these steps, mainframe, client server, PC, cloud, is a disruptive change. It is a big step change. It's not a gradual change. It is a change that really brings us to a different level of understanding and management. And disruptive change is not a trendy marketing word. It's a solid business innovation concept developed by Harvard Business School professor Clayton Christensen. According to Christensen, and I'm simplifying here, a disruptive innovation is about something that is not as good initially as the thing that it replaces. But it is much cheaper, so it appeals to people who are like overserved by the original product. Customers who could not afford the original product. And because of this, there's a good business model. And the new provider can afford to innovate further. Which means it can be rapidly improving. And when it's rapidly improving, it will eventually overtake the original and replace it and drive it out of the market. Let's look at some examples here. Like Wikipedia to start with. What was Wikipedia to begin with? It was nothing more than a handful of articles, nowhere near the completeness of the Encyclopedia Britannica. But it was good enough for a lot of people, and it was definitely a lot cheaper than the Encyclopedia Britannica. Fast forward a couple of years, and which is the one that survives? Is it Wikipedia, or is it the Encyclopedia Britannica? The PC is another example. The original PC was a really simple machine. It had only 64 kilobytes of memory. I remember that I saw one and I was thinking, hey, you cannot take this seriously. This is not a real computer. It can't even multitask. 64 kilobytes? Are you joking? My bootloader is bigger than that. But it has innovated and innovated and innovated. And we have now come to the point that your average server is a souped-up PC that's more powerful than the mainframe that it replaces. Now that's what we call a disruptive innovation. Of course, then we have the internet replacing leased lines at a fraction of the cost and all that. and then the next thing up, cloud computing. In the beginning, it did not sound like much, but it has evolved and evolved, and right now we have to understand that cloud computing can actually be better, cheaper, and safer than the style of computing it replaces. A few years ago, for example, I was measuring the uptime of cloud services, and back then they were already better than most corporate IT uptime. Each of these disruptive innovations has something you might call a tipping point. For a long time, the world is on one side, and suddenly, like a seesaw, it is tipped to the other side. And once it passes the threshold, most of it suddenly flips. You go like, hey, what happened? And if you're one of the people whose job is involved in the change, you can complain about it. You can say, it's a change for the worse. The mainframe was such a good machine. You can start complaining about it, you can keep complaining about it, or you can try to find out what you've learned in your last job and carry that over to the next generation of technology. I think you can do that, but that's a different story. So the end result for this, for IT, is that it's not your daddy's data center anymore. You know, the big fortress on the hill, protected by a large moat and big walls, it is no longer there. This is no longer the model for IT. Digital data is no longer confined to the walls of the data center. It's the whole world that's being connected, and your systems are basically plugged into that giant worldwide grid of interconnected machines. Now, what makes these developments happening? Well, the biggest driver for information technology has always been Moore's Law, by Gordon Moore, where we can see that every 2 years, the number of components in a chip doubles. As a result, the capacity in terms of processing and storage increases by more than an order of magnitude every decade. In my lifetime, I've seen the price-performance ratio of computing, storage, and bandwidth improve by a factor of 1 million. And that drop in price goes hand in hand with an increase in the amount of IT stuff that we have to manage. And you can imagine, that's also like orders of magnitude more. So what does that mean for the number of people that have to manage this? Is that increasing by orders of magnitude as well? No, it's not, because we don't have that many people. The productivity of managing that IT really has to go up. And it actually does go up. We started out with 10 people managing one computer. A little later, it was one person managing one computer. Then one person managing 10 computers. And now we see, for specific functions, people managing thousands or even tens of thousands of computers. So that productivity has to go up. At the same time, we need a lot more skills to run that stuff. We have more technology, we have more components, more programming languages, more interfaces, more different devices, more existing software. And our IT is having more of an impact on business and society. From the back office, it expanded into the front office. And from the front office, it moved to being the product for some companies. Like, think Netflix or Uber or Airbnb. But just about every company these days cannot go back to manual order taking or manual production control. And then the threat landscape in terms of the number of people that are trying to hack and abuse that technology is also increasing rapidly. Not to mention their skills level. That means that we need a lot more brain power to manage all that IT. A lot more brain power. And it's no longer feasible anymore to run that IT entirely in your own shop. We need a way to organize IT that does not force us to deploy 100 skilled people for a 100-person company. It doesn't work anymore. Now let's look at how that problem has been addressed historically. Henry Ford allegedly invented, or at least made big, the assembly line method of automobile production, where a lot of people were working on very specialist jobs in that assembly line. And that made productivity really go up massively. In IT, it's no different. We have specialists for just about everything. Network engineers, server admins, storage admins, database administrators, front-end and back-end software developers, and so on. But the parallels go much deeper. In this picture here, you can see how Ford's assembly line was laid out in his River Rouge factory. That factory was built out between 1910 and 1920, but it's still there. Yeah? The River Rouge plant was the first full assembly line cranking out cars. One end of the factory, through the River Rouge, ships would come in with iron ore. On the other end, T-forts would come out. In between was the assembly line, and everything needed to produce that car. The Ford company even had its own steel mill, its own electricity plant, its own glass factory. Everything was there on the River Rouge plant. At the time, it was the largest industrial estate in the world. But after the assembly line was introduced, other changes started happening. Fast forward a couple of decades later, and this plant is no longer exclusively owned by the Ford Motor Company. What happened was that that division of labor was extended beyond the company. Components of the whole factory were outsourced. The Ford Company no longer owns the steel mill. It is outsourced to another company with more steel mills. It no longer owns the electricity plant. That's now part of a large electricity company. Again, we see specialization, and this time beyond the borders of a specific company. The assembly line has now become part of a supply chain of companies, each of which delivers to the next company downstream in the flow of goods. Specialization of labor above the level of an individual company. And currently, only 20% of the value of the car is produced by the car company. The rest is outsourced. The same thing has happened with Apple. The original Apple I computer was developed around 1978 by Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak. So the first order was 50 of these by an electronics shop. And the Steves soldered these together on the kitchen table in Steve Jobs' parents' house. Again, fast forward a few decades, and this is what the iPhone supply chain looks like now. It is produced around the entire world. Apple no longer manufactures these. It's all outsourced. And the only thing that Apple does these days is design them and market them. They are produced in global supply chains. But this also creates its own new problems. In a supply chain, we can no longer solve production glitches by having one department head talk to another department head. We need to make the control over that supply chain more explicit. I ran into an example of that last year when I was delivering a course in Tunisia. At night in the hotel, I chatted up with a German guy. Turns out he was there to audit the supply chain of a big German car manufacturer. And a company in Tunisia was producing a part of the electrical system of the car, not even the whole electrical system. And the guy was out there to audit their process. He didn't even look much at the product, only at the process. If the process is good, the product will be good. And he was coming back every couple of months or so to audit that part of the supply chain. He also explained that if this company stopped delivering, the assembly line in Germany would stop in 48 hours. So they had strict delivery agreements and fines when they failed. The upshot of all this is that today's car is not only cheaper, comparatively, it is also more fuel efficient, more functional, safer, it is better in all dimensions, and you can even get it in another color than black. And this is how specialization of labor in a supply chain works. And with cloud computing, it is a similar thing. Cloud computing basically creates an IT services supply chain. Here's a diagram that shows how that might look like, simplified. As a cloud customer, you consume services from a software as a services provider. And a lot of these SaaS providers actually have their own infrastructure sourced upstream. Of course, the reality is a little bit more complicated than this. It more looks like this picture, where you have a ton of SaaS providers. You know, the average company has a few hundred. Similarly, a lot of platform providers upstream. And then it's all hosted on Amazon. No, just kidding. There's also hosting on Microsoft, Google, and a few others. And some SaaS providers actually host it themselves. So there you have it. The IT services supply chain. The new model for delivering IT services. Better, cheaper, safer, potentially. More complicated. More moving parts. More people to manage it. Different ways to control it. And now the fun starts. Once we have this, what happens? Once we have this, new things become possible. New things that might include your future job role. Once we have programmable infrastructure, we can do automated integration, automated testing, automated deployment. We can do DevOps. Once we have flexible capacity at scale, we can do big data. Once we have that stuff out there on the network, it makes more sense to develop social and mobile applications. for individuals as well as for companies. And as a consequence, it has never been cheaper or easier to start a software company or set up any company's IT for that matter. I reckon that if you put your mind to it, even with a team of just two or three people, you can start a company, including its entire development pipeline, in less than a day, just by procuring the right cloud services. Let's focus on one of these. The one that's really driving this IT transformation from the business perspective is the DevOps revolution. Back in the old days, a new version of the software was released once a year. It took a while to implement. It had to be installed on all the machines, databases, migrated, and so on. Very complicated. With DevOps, you can automate a lot of the entire software development and deployment pipeline. This is called continuous integration or even continuous delivery. And it allows companies such as Amazon, Netflix, banks, .coms to deploy new services or bits of services literally thousands of times a day. And that creates for their business enormous agility, enormous feature velocity, which allows them to innovate quicker and better and adapt quicker to the market. And as you remember from Darwin, it's not the strongest of species that survive, but the ones that can adapt to changing circumstances quicker. And it's the same for companies. Now, if you are in IT or related to IT, what are you going to do with this? What should you do? I mean, this is a new world. This is inevitable. It is already there. This is the new way that IT will be run. Of course, it will take another 10 years for this to reach 95% saturation, but there's only one way. There's only one direction that this is going. We still have mainframes, but there's not a lot of work in mainframes. We still have mini computers, but there's not a lot of work in mini computers anymore. We still have PCs, but there's not so much work in managing these anymore. In fact, we're often leaving that to the users. Cloud computing is where the new action is. If you want to succeed in that world, you have to know about the nuts and bolts, how it is pieced together. You have to know how to control suppliers and everybody in that ecosystem, everybody upstream from you. And you have to demonstrate to the people downstream that you are in control. You have to know how to control all kinds of risks. And you need to know where you fit in that ecosystem. Don't be stuck. And once you get it, there's a great new world out there.
Do you want to know more? Subscribe to my YouTube channel or sign up for my ebook. My name is Peter van Eyck, and this is the inevitable coming of cloud computing.